Thanks so much for joining us for this Good Friday experience. My name is Stu Hodges, and I really believe the next few moments that we share together, well, they're going to be so meaningful and impactful as we reflect and remember the events of that fateful Friday so long ago. Maybe you're wondering, why do we celebrate Good Friday? Well, it's because Good Friday is necessary to get to Easter Sunday. The pain and agony of the cross, it's necessary to celebrate the victory and the triumph of the empty tomb. And that's why this, it's so important. What we're doing today is really preparing us for what we'll celebrate later this weekend. And I believe that because you're investing this time to remember Good Friday, your heart's going to be ready to celebrate Easter Sunday like never before. So you're going to need a few things to make the most of this experience. Later in the service, we're going to share communion together as we reflect on the sacrifice of Jesus. So you'll want to go ahead now and have some bread and some juice ready. And if all you find is a cracker and some water, well, that's fine too. Jesus said these are symbols of his body and his blood that help us remember his sacrifice. So go ahead and get those together. And then I just want to encourage you to shut out all the distractions for just a little while. This isn't really an experience designed to play in the background. It really deserves your full attention. So whether you're by yourself on the back patio, or maybe you're with friends in your dorm room, or with family at the dining room table, I just want to encourage you to silence the noise around you and fully immerse yourself in the scriptures that we'll read and the songs that we'll sing, because I believe that God wants to speak to you today. So welcome to Good Friday, and now open your heart and prepare to receive as together we reflect and remember the journey of Jesus to the cross of Calvary.
When evening came, Jesus was reclining at the table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives.
Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer."
That's just what the mercy of God can do. Now I'm alive to tell the story of how I've overcome. It's His goodness and mercy and the power of His blood. I'm so glad that my freedom wasn't based on what I've and mercy and the power of the blood. So much power in the blood. I said, the choices made that I regret. Oh, I would still be lost. Oh, but for the mercy of God. So I'm alive to tell the story how I've overcome. His goodness and mercy and the power of His blood. I'm so glad that my freedom wasn't based on what I've done, but the goodness and mercy and the power of His blood. Oh, it's the power of my Savior. Was the cross meant for me that my Savior carried? Now I've been made free by the mercy of God. Was the grave meant for me where my sin lay buried? Now I stand redeemed by the mercy of God. Was the cross meant for me where my Savior carried? Now I've been made free by the mercy of God. Was the grave meant for me where my sin?
and the power of his blood. It's his goodness and mercy and the power of his blood. It's his goodness and mercy and the power of his blood. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. It still heals today. Oh, yes, it does. There's the power in the blood. 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 Oh, wonder working power.
Power in the blood.
Wonder working power.
There's the power in the blood.
Chain breaking power. Losing power.
There's the power in the blood.
I know that I know.
There's
I know.
The power in the blood.
There's 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 the power in the blood.
So much power in the blood.
There's the power in the blood.
So much power in the blood. The cross. By the mercy of God, yeah. Oh, so what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole? What can wash? What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me? And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. You sing nothing. His blood, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, nothing but the blood of
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived with him, with a large crowd, armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him. "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way?" In that hour, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. When he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. Then Pilate asked him, "Don't you hear the testimony they are bringing against you?" But Jesus made no reply, not even to a single charge, to the great amazement of the governor. Now it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. At that time, they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Jesus Barabbas. So when the crowd had gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he knew it was out of self-interest that they had handed Jesus over to him. While Pilate was sitting on the judge's seat, his wife sent him this message, "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have suffered a great deal today in a dream because of him." "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." All the people answered, "His blood is on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified.
I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. My richest gain I count but loss, and poor contempt on all my pride. See, from his head, his hands, his feet, love and sorrow bring, or thorns come forth so rich a crown. Oh, the wonderful cross, oh, bids me come and die, find that I might truly live. Oh, the one.
The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews." Again and again, they struck him on the head with a staff and spit on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. A certain man from Cyrene, Simon, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country, and they forced him to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And then they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice charged against him read, "King of the Jews." They who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads, saying, "So, you are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it? Come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He, King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him heaped insults on him, At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing near heard this, they said, listen, he's calling to Elijah. Someone ran and filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. Now leave him alone and let's see if Elijah comes to take him down. He said with a loud cry. Jesus breathed his last.
It was preparation day, that is, the day before the Sabbath. So as evening approached, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council, who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Pilate was surprised to hear that he was already dead. Summoning the centurion, he asked him if Jesus had already died. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he gave the body to Joseph. So Joseph brought some linen cloth, took down the body, wrapped it in the linen, and placed it in a tomb cut out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb.
What a story. What a sacrifice. All for you and for me, for the payment of our sin, so that we might be forgiven and made righteous before God. That's the power of the cross. It's a forever symbol of love and forgiveness, of mercy and grace, of redemption and restoration, and we never want to forget. You know, we use that phrase, never forget, about a lot of things, a lot of very impactful and meaningful things in our lives and in our world. But I never want to forget the price Jesus paid on the cross for my sin. And that's why we celebrate communion. Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Take communion to remind yourselves and each other of me. Because when we eat the bread and we drink the juice, it reminds us of the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. In fact, later in the Bible, when Paul explains communion, this is what he says. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are retelling the story, proclaiming our Lord's death until he comes. Isn't that beautiful? Today in your living room, today in the hospital room, today on your lunch break at the office, you're retelling the story of Jesus and you're proclaiming, Jesus died for me. He paid the price for me. And when you eat the bread and you drink the juice, you're declaring, I will live for him. Think about that. He died for me, so I will live for him. And I want to invite you to make that proclamation, that declaration, as together we remember the sacrifice of Jesus. And communion is really meant to be shared by those who know Jesus. So if you don't yet have a relationship with him, right now, it's the perfect time to say to Jesus, I want to know you. I want a relationship with you. I want to receive your forgiveness and I want to live my life for you. You could pray a prayer like that right now and Jesus will hear you and the Bible says he will save you. And parents, this is the perfect opportunity for you to help your kids understand what a relationship with Jesus, well, what that's all about. And if your kids haven't yet made that decision for themselves, maybe they can have a different snack while you take communion. Because today, the bread and the juice should be for those who've accepted Jesus' forgiveness and who are living their lives for him. So if that's you, then let's take a moment to remember. I'm going to break off a piece of this bread. You take your bread there at home, and we eat this bread to symbolize the body of Jesus that was broken for us. This was the price that Jesus paid for us. And Jesus said, this is my body broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me. The juice symbolizes the blood of Jesus spilled for us so that we can be made righteous, clean, and holy. The Bible says there can be no forgiveness of sin without the shedding of blood. So this juice is really a reminder that Jesus shed his blood to pay for our sin on the cross. Jesus took the cup and he said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Drink this in remembrance of me. Let's pray together. Father, today we pause to remember. And we are overwhelmed with gratitude. We thank you for the price paid for our sin. Jesus, we thank you for enduring the pain of the cross, for walking through those dark and difficult days to be able to pay for my sin so that I can be made righteous before God. We're overwhelmed today with gratitude, thanksgiving, as we remember the sacrifice of Jesus. We thank you for this time we've shared together, for the elements of communion, for the bread and the juice reflective of your body and blood. We pray that we would never forget the sacrifice. Today we declare that you died for us, so we will live for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Well, as you know, Good Friday is only part of the story. The rest of the story, the best part of the story, it continues this weekend. And I hope you'll join me for Easter services at Water's Edge Church, because this isn't the end. In fact, it's only the beginning. May God bless you as you continue to reflect on and remember the sacrifice of Jesus.